Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to our services this morning. We have a good number of our members, and I see a few visitors as well, and we're grateful. If you are visiting, we're truly grateful that you're here. You're our welcome guest, and if you'd like to fill out a card and pass it towards the center aisle, we'll have a record of your presence this morning. We'd appreciate that. And if you are visiting, please hang around after services and let us have a chance to meet you. This morning we'll be led in opening prayer by Mike Broad. Our closing prayer will be led by Chip Broad. If you take a songbook and turn to 627, number 627 will be our opening song. We'll be led in singing this morning by Carrie Rosenblum. Looks like our monitor is showing our sick and shut-ins, but keep these in mind. They're also listed in our bulletin. Update on Lois Webster. He is in Health South rehab, but to understand is some improvement, so that's good news. And let's keep all these in our prayers. Primetimers will meet in the fellowship hall for a potluck meal on Tuesday, February the 14th at 11 a.m. instead of going to the Olive Garden as previously announced. If you have any questions about this, see Jack Taylor. The Ladies Helping Hands will meet Thursday, February the 22nd in the fellowship hall for a salad lunch. This month they are collecting money for snacks for the homeless of the inner city congregation. Bring a salad and enjoy the food and fellowship. If you have any questions on this activity, see Sue Wirtz. A baby basket is being prepared for Jason and Kelsey Smith. They're expecting a girl. This basket is located outside the secretary's office. Tim's Sunday morning class will be going to Shogun Japanese Steakhouse tomorrow night at 6. If you'd like to go along, sign the sheet in the foyer. And if you sign the list, you need to go, according to Tim, to make sure the reservation count is correct. That's tomorrow night. So you sign the list today. Bicycle donations. If you have a bike that's no longer being used, please check with Mike Broad. We want to refurbish and repair some bikes and have these available for the community day to hand out to some children. And you may be called upon as well to help repair if we have any bikes that need a repair. The food item for this week is 16-ounce canned ham for our community day as we prepare for that. Congregational singing at Madison is an area-wide a cappella singing Friday night, February the 17th at 7. A parenting seminar at West Huntsville. They're hosting a parenting seminar March the 4th through the 5th. The dangers of a cell phone for teens and their parents. Schedule is listed here in the bulletin. Remember, Puppet Team 2, you'll be active this evening. Puppet Team 2. Ushers, if you'll pick up the visitor's cards, please. I've been announcing that we're already collecting money for the house bills during the mission trip to Honduras. The cost is $1,600 per house. But any amount would be appreciated if you want to participate in that. The Primetimers Valentine's dinner will be tonight after evening service. So don't forget that if you made plans to go. There will be a teen and college Devo next Sunday night at Michael and Beth Rosenblum's. The theme is soup and singing, but not at the same time. So please bring soups, sides, drinks, and desserts. Ladies' Night Out will be Monday, February the 20th at Francis Smallwood's. Details to follow on that. Thank you, card to read. Maysville Church, I would like to thank all of you for the prayers, cards, and concerns for me during the last 7 months. God is great. I am now cancer-free. Herschel Miles and family. Begin our worshiping with prayer.
Will you bow with me, please? Our God and our Father, we are so thankful for this day that you have given to us, where we can come into this building and its comforts and study thy word from Bible class and have worship this morning, have communion, have offering, have prayer, all free from outside sources. Father, these are just one of the gifts that you give to us each and every week of our lives, and let us always remember this and put you first in our lives. We're thankful for the opportunities that we do have as the announcements were read. There's many things that are going on in this congregation that if you want to be busy or if you want to do any type of work, all you have to do is ask or seek, and we can put you to work. And we're thankful for all those that are over certain areas. We're thankful for our elders. We ask that you continue to be with these three men as they work and they lead us and they make decisions. And we hope, Father, that as they do make these decisions, that we as a congregation can thank them for this and help them out in every way possible. And I'm thankful for my brothers that helps along with the avenues of deaconship for what the elders have asked us to do. And we hope, Father, that we can do these things that will help those of our congregations that from here and abroad. Thankful for Brother Tim and others that stand before us, especially Tim and his family, for the years that they have put forth with us. We ask, Father, that he will continue to preach thy word in its purity and in its simplicity. Father, at this time, as mentioned, there are numerous ones that are sick, some at home, some have made it with us today. I'll try to remember as many as I can, but Father, we ask that you be with them and help them and get them back on their feet. We ask that you be with Philip and be with Dolly. Yes, be with Gordon and Glonda. Be with Betty. Be with Shirley. Be with Eugene. Be with Lois. I'm sure there are others, Father, but we realize that sometimes we do get down in sickness or in health. And hopefully, Father, they can bounce back and be with us once again. Father, we are so thankful for our young people and for what they mean to us. And we hope, Father, that they will have many days here upon this earth. And they will do the things that you would want them to do. And we hope, Father, that we are older, that those of us that are older, that we can do those things that can help them and steer them in the right direction. Father, the Bible class that we had this morning, for all the little kids that we have here today, and we hope, Father, that just one little thing was mentioned, one small thing was heard. And the song that they will sing as they go home or as they go to the restaurant, may I have an everlasting effect upon their lives and their souls, will be yours one day. Father, we're mindful of those men and women who serve us on a daily basis, who keep us protected, whether it be local from fire, police, rescue, EMTs, those that fight for us on foreign soil. We hope, Father, that this will be a peaceful nation, a nation that people will want to look up to. We pray for these and we hope that the safety of them will always be there and that we can pray for them every day. Fathers, we go into the rest of this day. We hope, Father, that we can put you first in our lives as we come in contact with our friends, our family, co-workers, fellow students, that whatever we say and whatever we do is from your word. Well, Father, as we go from this day forward, that you will guide us and guard us and always be with us. And these things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. 627, we'll do the first and second stanzas, please. I'm in the way, the bright and shining way. I'm in the glory land way. Telling the world that Jesus saves today. Yes, I'm in the glory land way. I'm in the glory land way.
Number 277, we'll do the first and second of this one as well.
I have heard of the land, oh, far away strife, till the beautiful home of the soul, filled by Jesus on high, where we never shall die, till
that you don't have, but you'll see on the screen. 238, we're going to sing first three stanzas of this before our Lord's Supper. In Christ alone, we have numerous verses in the New Testament that points to the fact that only through Christ we'll have redemption and salvation. no other name that's given among men whereby we must be saved. So if we're seeking for salvation, we have to go through Christ. And it's in Him that we remember His life today and His death and His, most of all, His resurrection. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, shown by the ones He came to save.
Bow with me, please. Father in heaven, as we come to you at this time, we are indeed thankful for the blessings that you give us in life. Father, especially for the sacrifice of your Son. Father, we pray that as we look back to the cross and remember this and partake of this bread, which represents His broken body, we do so in a manner that's well-pleasing in thy sight. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Father, at this time, we are not only thankful for the bread that represents Christ's broken body, but for the blood that was shed for our sins, for the scourging that took place, and when he's hung on the cross, and the piercing that his body endured, and the blood that represents that connection that we now have, and salvation that we have when this life is over. Let us take it in a manner real pleasing in your sight. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
This morning, and we should give, certainly have different concepts and general attitude of wanting to give back to God, but out of humility, I stress this morning or mention, humility is something that realizes our position with God is very insignificant, and one that we should give back to Him, not proudfully or in a way that makes us feel big or important. Proverbs writer, Solomon there in one of his chapters mentioned several things that the Lord hates, and one of them is a proud look, the very first thing. So our humility is important when we get back to God, realizing that we wouldn't have earned it without the health He gave us or the opportunities He presented. On bended knee I come with a humble
make my life, O Holy Priest. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you now to thank you for the opportunities that you give us, the opportunity we have to be here, the opportunity we have to give back, and to remember that everything we have is yours, and we are just stewards of it. May we be good stewards and give back what is rightfully thine with a cheerful heart. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
If you'd like to, please mark 683. 683 will be our song after the lesson this morning. Now we'll sing number 660. 660, we'll do the first, third, and fourth stanzas. If you'd like to, please stand. We'll sing it together.
There is a habitation built by the
It is good to see you this morning. It is always good to look out and see brethren, but we have so many sick folks. We have had people that have
seasonal distress and have had a number of surgeries and lots of other sickness, and we're glad to see you here. A lot of our folks are not able to be with us this morning and have been out for some time. And if you're of that group and have been away from us and are back, we're glad that you're back. And we still have some who aren't with us, and we hope that they will soon be back out and about. Look around your place. The folks we normally sit around, and I know you recognize we do things the same so often. We get into a routine. Look around your spot. And the folks who are normally there that are missing, give them a call. Reach out and let them know that you appreciate them and that you sympathize with their needs. There may be something you can do for them. I have one piece of information I've got to pass along. I neglected in my Sunday morning Bible class to pass out the list for you to sign for those of you who are going to go eat with us tomorrow night at Shogun at 6 o'clock. That list is now posted in the foyer, across from the secretary's office, on the sign-up board. Make sure that you sign that list. Your name will have to be on the list for you to go with us, and we would love for you to do that. And there's a note for that in the bulletin. Imagine a visitor comes to see us. They've never been to the worship services before. Perhaps they're a friend of yours or someone that you know. And they come in and they sit through our services and they watch and observe. And afterward, you have an opportunity to talk. And they comment on what their experiences were. Says, well, I understand and need that you have to make announcements and provide information regarding the group and watched as you sang, heard the music, saw the words, participation in the Lord's Supper, reading from the Bible, preaching. But explain what it means when you bow your head together and one speaks. Why do you pray? I suspect that the answers that we would give might first fall to a common explanation of why we do certain things. And that explanation might be something along this line, which would be a typical sermon, perhaps, on prayer. And you'd begin with a statement, something like, well, that's what Jesus did. And here's where Jesus spent time in prayer. The Gospel of Mark opens up in Mark chapter 1. And how quickly we get to a discussion of Jesus himself and his own particular practices. Mark 1:35, now in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out and departed to a solitary place, and there he prayed. Or we'd find ourselves in Matthew chapter 14, and the back story to what takes place is back in verse 13. The first few verses of the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 14, tell us about John the Baptist and all the things that took place with him, and then his death in verse 12. And it says in verse 13, when Jesus heard this, he departed from there by boat to a deserted place by himself. Jesus was trying to find personal alone time so that he could pray to God, but he's not able to be alone. The crowds follow him. They seek him out. They find him, and there's a whole multitude there with their illnesses and troubles. They followed him on foot. Verse 14, when Jesus went out, he saw a great multitude. He was moved with compassion for them and healed their sick. Now it comes to evening, and it needs to send them away, but not hungry. So He has his disciples feed them. Finally, the feeding is taken care of. The loaves and the fish are provided. The fragments are taken up. In verse 22, Matthew 14. Immediately he made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. Jesus is looking for prayer time. He's finding that time by himself. Then we can find him in Matthew chapter 26. And of course, you're very familiar with that story. The final night of his life. The crucifixion is coming. And he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane and he puts his disciples down and says, "You stay here." And says, and he went a little farther and there he prayed. We pray because Jesus prayed, we would say. Not only did Jesus pray, but Jesus expected us to pray. And then we would look to other discussions. For example, in Matthew chapter 5, verse 44, when Jesus said for you to love your enemies and to pray for those who spitefully use and persecute you. Pray for them. Jesus expected his disciples to be involved in prayer. Or we might find ourselves in Matthew chapter 6, and here the topic of prayer comes again, verse 5, Matthew 6, 5, when you pray, and the statement, you shall not be like the hypocrites, they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the street that they may be seen by men. Verse 6, but when you pray, go into your room. When you've shut your door, pray to your Father who is in secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. And when you pray, verse 7. And finally, it comes down to verse 9. In this manner, therefore, pray. And you know that model, that sometimes we describe it as the model prayer or the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Jesus expected his disciples to be praying. There's a wonderful passage that Jesus quotes from in the book of Isaiah. And if we had unlimited time, we would go back and read most of Isaiah chapter 56, but we don't have that time. But Isaiah in chapter 56 is preparing the people of God for what's going to take place, and all of the folks who are outcast, and God is calling them in so that they can be there. Verse 3, Isaiah 56, do not let the son of the foreigner who has joined himself to the Lord speak, saying, the Lord has utterly separated me from his people. Nor let the eunuch say, here I am a dry tree, for thus says the Lord to the eunuch who keeps my Sabbath, and who chooses what pleases me and holds fast my covenant, even to them I will give in my house, and within my walls a place and a name better than that of sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. And also the sons of the foreigner who join themselves to the Lord to serve him and to love the name of the Lord, to be his servant, everyone who keeps from defiling the Sabbath and holds my covenant, even them I will bring to my holy mountain. But then Jesus quotes. And he quotes from the book of Isaiah, and he says, my house should be called a house of prayer. And all of those who are outside can come in and they can pray. I wonder if we see our house as a house of prayer. Verse 7, I will bring them into my holy mountain, make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. Why do we pray? Jesus prayed. We're expected to pray. And we might describe how we're commanded to pray. And you're familiar with these. Romans chapter 12, verse 12. Continue steadfast in prayer. Or Colossians 4, 2. Continuing earnestly in prayer. Or 1 Thessalonians 5, 17. Pray without ceasing. Or the statements that Paul makes to Timothy. When to Timothy he's describing more than just a simple statement, but how they are going to prepare their life. 1 Timothy 2, 1. Therefore I exhort first of all that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, for all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. Verse 8, I desire therefore that the men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. And our friend says, okay. I get all that. Jesus prayed. He expected you to pray. You're commanded to pray. But why do you pray? What? I just answered that. Yes, but why do you pray? Is there something deeper that draws us into a prayer life with God? When you bow your head in prayer, are these the reasons you would give? I bow my head in prayer because Jesus prayed. He expects us to pray. I'm commanded to pray. Is that what leads you to prayer? That's not what leads me to prayer. Then what does? What leads you to prayer? And so if we leave what would be a relatively simple explanation in most ways and we dig down a little deeper, what do we find? And as we spend our time there, we might find lots of reasons and explanations. I'll limit our discussion here this morning to just four. Number one, we pray because of God. We meet God in Scripture. The book of Genesis is the book of beginnings. It tells us about where things came from. When you open your Bible to the very first page, it tells us about God. God. In the beginning, created the heavens and the earth. And you're familiar with the phrasing, at least from the King James Version, how that God formed these things and that the Spirit of God was over the face of the deep, the void, the shapeless. And as God brings order from that and then brings up dry land and then brings up plants and animals to dwell on it, and we find God in creation. Then as we move down, still in the first chapter, and we find the discussion of God as He has come to humanity, and God says, let us make man in our image, like us. And so in the image of God, we are created. The whole of creation, everything that around us, the world, life, our all the forces that are there, they're held together by God. Then we can move on a little farther and we find ourselves perhaps over in Genesis chapter 12. As God explains to Abraham the reason why Abraham is being called, and He says, you come and walk before me. I'm going to make you a great nation. I will make you a mighty people. Every place that you the sole of your foot goes, you will own this property. Your descendants will come to possess it. And Abraham comes and follows. And God tells him in Genesis chapter 12, verse 3, in you all nations of the earth will be, or all families of the earth will be blessed. God said that to Abraham. In chapter 15, a little later, God renews His promise to Abraham and says, I'm going to make you a great and mighty nation. And Abraham says, you've made this promise. You've told me I'll be a mighty nation, but the heir of my house is a stranger. God says, come outside. Look up into the sky. Can you count the stars? If you've ever been out in the clear darkness of a winter sky, away from the city and the lights that drown out the heavenly lights, the stars are countless. And we know from, if we had better vision from the images of telescopes, that the stars, even in the dark places of the night sky, if you could see better as you zoom in, that the stars just come out of the darkness. The sky is filled. It's countless stars. God says, these will be yours. None of them had been yet. They didn't exist at that time, but God said they would be. When Paul, in Romans chapter 4, draws from the discussion that's held there in Genesis chapter 12 and Genesis chapter 15, and Paul brings these things and makes an application. Start reading with me if you'd like to in Romans chapter 4, verse 17. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations in the presence of him whom he believed, God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did, who, contrary to hope, in hope believed so that he became the father of many nations according to what was spoken, so shall your descendants be. We could read all the way down to the end. And all of these things are applied to us. Why do we pray? We pray because of God, of who God is, of what God promised, of God's vision for the future. In Genesis chapter 15, we didn't read it, but God tells Abraham, here's what's going to happen. Your nation, your family is going to be taken down into another nation. And they'll spend 400 years there. But then I will bring them out and I will bring them to this land. And Paul says, God called things as existing that did not yet. We pray to God, who sees the future, who knows all things, who upholds all things, who created all things, by whom we have come to exist, and in whose image we exist as living, sentient beings. But we also pray because of our own weakness. I don't like being weak, do you? Most of us like being strong. We don't like to admit things that we can't do. We don't like to admit limitations. We deny. We try to cover up. We do everything we can to stay away from a time of weakness. We exercise. We eat right. We make for ourselves devices for us to make us stronger, to make us capable. We go to war to prove our strength. We go to the moon to prove our capabilities. And as a people, we are strong. But individually, us by ourselves, we are weak. And we are limited by so many things. In order for us to exist, even to be here, it is necessary for us to constantly be provided with water, with food, with rest, with shelter. And you miss these even for a little while, and things quickly go badly. Frailty is built into us by God. Our nature, our stature is what it is because God has made us this way. There's a wonderful story in Judges chapter 6 and 7. Judges chapter 6, we're introduced to a period of time where Israel is being overrun by the Midianites. God has allowed, because of the sin of Israel, for foreign peoples to come and make Israel weak. And now Israel is very weak, and the Midianites have camped out. We meet Gideon, the leader that God is bringing up to bring some measure of stability back to the people of Israel. And Gideon is a hiding man. He is a frightened man. He is living away from the foreigners, and he is trying to protect his family and provide some grain, some food for them. And an angel comes and tells him he's a mighty man. And Gideon responds and says, "If I'm such a mighty man, why are we all living in caves and why are we all afraid?" And the angel said, "God is going to raise you up to be the power." Gideon doesn't feel powerful. He questions the angel as of the veracity of the truthfulness of it. And he goes through the tests of the fleece and the dew. You remember that story. Finally, Gideon is convinced, and Gideon stands before God and calls all the children of Israel together to come together to war. "We are going to go and fight against the Midianites." And so in chapter 7, all of the Israelites have gathered together to fight against Midian. And God says, "There's too many people here. We can't go to war like this." Why? Judges chapter 7 verse 2, God says, "We can't go to war like this because after we go to war and you win, Israel will say, 'See, we have defeated them by our own hand.'" And God says, "I want you to know that it is nothing that you do, it's what I do for you that's going to bring you. You are weak. You can do nothing. I'm going to provide for you." So he tells Gideon, "Send everybody home who's afraid." 2/3 of the people leave. There's still 10,000 there, and God says, "That's still too many. Take them down to the river and let them drink." And there were 300 men who lapped water in a particular way, and God says, "Take them. Take that 300. So now Gideon with his 300 stands, and God says, "By this group, I will deliver you." And now Gideon is afraid again. When he had thousands there, he had strength. But now, down to 300, and God says, "You're afraid, aren't you? You don't think you'll win." He says, "I want you to sneak down to the camp of the Midianites tonight. If you're afraid, take a servant with you and listen to what they're saying." So Gideon takes his servant, and they sneak down, and they listen. And Gideon overhears a couple of the soldiers talking, and he says, one of them says, I had a dream. And the end of the dream, there was a loaf of bread that rolled into our camp. Just a loaf of bread, and it knocked down our tents, and it destroyed us all. And the other man said, it's Gideon that you're seeing. God is telling us that Gideon's army is going to roll over us. They are weak. They are nothing. They're like a loaf of bread, but they are going to flatten us. Gideon hears that dream from the enemies, and he comes back knowing that God is going to provide for him. And Gideon takes his forces into battle, and you know what they carry into battle? Nothing. They're weaponless. They've got a torch in one hand and a trumpet in the other. Now, how do you fight a battle with a torch and a trumpet? You're not going to fight the battle. At the time that was called, they were to show their light. It was hidden inside a device, and they broke it open, and now the light would shine out. And now suddenly there's this light surrounding the enemies, and the trumpets sound, and the enemy of God was defeated by God Himself. Weakness. Weakness is there. And you know how Paul describes his own life and flesh? In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, as Paul is describing his relationship with God, and more importantly, what has happened to him because of God, and he explains why he has come to the situation he is. 2 Corinthians 12:7, lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning this thing I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. He said, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and needs and persecutions and distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. How is it that Paul came to understand his strength and weakness? Because that's when he relied on God's power, not his own. That's what prayer is. Prayer is our turning from our own strength and the recognition of our weakness and our frailty and our limitations to the power of God. And we say, God, help me. God, watch over me. Because I'm weak. And I have need. Well, why would we turn to God? We pray because of our faith. Faith means trust. Who or what do you put your trust in? Pull money out of your pocket. What does it say on it? Well, somewhere on it, it will probably say, in God we trust. The reality is a whole lot of people live their lives and in money they trust. Or in doctors they trust. Or in the power of the United States they trust, or in their bank account they trust, or in their house they trust, or there may be all kinds of their own strength, their own power, their own education, their own skill set, their own abilities. There are a whole lot of things that people actually trust in. And it's not always God. There are many things in life that we look to, perhaps, that really have no strength in them at all. In the book of Jeremiah, chapter 2, when the Lord was trying to bring Judah into line and they were fighting against God, and it would be that God is actually going to take Judah and send them off into captivity. But before he does it, in explaining his reasoning, Jeremiah 2:26. As the thief is ashamed when he is found out, so is the house of Israel ashamed. They and their kings and their princes and their priests and their prophets, saying to a tree, you are my father. To a stone, you gave birth to me. For they have turned their back to me and not their face. But in the time of their trouble, they will say, arise and save us. But where are your gods that you have made for yourselves? Let them arise if they can save you in the time of trouble. Verse 29, why will you plead with me? You see, when God saw the children of Israel and they turned away in idolatry, but then when trouble comes, when problems are there, they don't call out to their idols. They call out to God. God, save us. And God says, why are you calling me? You got your carved tree idol here. Go bow down before that. You've got your carved stone idol over here. Go call on them. Oh, now you're really in trouble. When do you go to God in prayer? You see, much of the time we turn to our other gods. We'll turn to the God of our money or the God of our doctors, or we'll turn to the God of our power or the God of our friends or others that we put our trust in our... Is it only at the end that we turn to God in prayer? Or has our trust been there all along? If time would allow, we'd read from 1 Kings chapter 18 and the discussion that takes place there between Elijah and the 450 prophets of Baal. And Elijah comes up and says, choose, decide, what God are you going to serve? Are you going to serve the false gods, the Baals, or are you going to serve the true God? And Elijah devised a test according to the will of God. He says, let's make a sacrifice. We'll put the animals on the sacrifice on the altar, and then we'll see who can bring fire to it. You go first, Elijah says. And the prophets of Baal dance and yell and scream. And about noon, hours later, Elijah starts taunting them. Hey, maybe you need to be a little louder. Maybe your God's on vacation. Maybe he's asleep. Maybe he's busy doing all kinds of things. And so it goes like that all day long. Finally, the evening sacrifice time comes. And Elijah says, okay, you've had your chance. Now it's my turn. And he rebuilds the altar with 12 stones, the required number for the people of Israel. And he cuts his sacrifice and puts it on the altar, the wood and the animals. Then he says, draw water and pour it on the altar. And they cover everything with water. He says, do it again. Cover it again. A third time, they cover it. There's water that's running off the sacrifice. It's just down into the trench that's been dug around it. It's now soaking wet. How do you start a fire that's soaking wet? It's a challenge. And then Elijah prays to God and says, God, the God of gods, show this stubborn people who you really are. And fire falls from heaven and lights that fire. And it burns up the sacrifice. And it licked up all the water that was surrounding it. And it consumed even the altar. And then Elijah says, okay, folks, now who's God? And the people say, the Lord, he is God. Why do we pray? We pray because of who God is. We pray because of our weakness and because of our trust and our faith in God. And also for our hope. The concept of hope is expectation. And I'll just read this quickly. When Peter says and writes for us in 1 Peter chapter 1, if you'd like to follow along, beginning in verse 13. Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lusts as in your ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. And then tells them about how they're going to live. Verse 18, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish, without spot. He was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for you, who through him believe in God who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Why do we pray? Because of God. Because of his power. Because of his revelation. Why do we pray? Because we are without strength, and we are frail, and we are weak, and we are needy. And why do we pray? Because we trust in the power of God and the promises that God has made for us to watch over us and provide for us, not just in this physical world, but in the world in which to come. And we pray because we have hope in God, the expectation that God has provided a place for us where we will spend eternity with God. And that's why Elijah prayed. And that's why Paul prayed. And yes, that's why Jesus prayed. We're going to sing a song in just a moment. And it describes a change in life, a change in status. From the person who is in sin, who is covered in transgressions, who is away from God, to the person who has been redeemed, who has been washed, who has been brought back. And it may be this morning that you have not yet been redeemed and brought back. And you need to take action this morning to change your life. The gospel of Jesus Christ was proclaimed so that those who would believe in Jesus Christ would change their lives in repentance. And whoever would believe in Jesus would alter their life in repentance and then be baptized for the remission of sins and live and walk a new life. And if this morning you are not walking that new life, then begin today. It may be that you are a child of God, but you're not faithful in His service. You need to come home. The invitation of Christ is extended to you. This morning, if there is anything we can do for you spiritually, we invite you to come as we stand and sing.
Will be our closing song in a moment. 144, we'll do the first, third, and fourth stanzas. We thank you for being here this morning. If you're visiting with us, hope you'll come back at a future time. We will meet at 5 this evening if you can come back then and look for you if you're able to be here. We'll have our closing prayer after these three stanzas.
Father, hear the prayer we offer. No.
Bow together.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all the many blessings that you give us. We thank you for allowing us to come and worship you this morning. We ask you to watch over the sick, bring them back to health. If it be your will, be with those that have lost loved ones and comfort them as only you can. Be with us as we go throughout this afternoon and bring us back tonight, if it be your will. In Jesus' name, amen.